chances are you've heard of convicted serial rapist Daniel Holtzclaw, the former Oklahoma City police officer. The case made national headlines and became a cause célèbre for Black Lives Matter in the social justice crowd as a symbol of, quote, 400 years of racial and sexual violence against black women. Members of Black Lives Matter and similar groups cheered when he was sentenced to 263 years behind bars. But is the case really so black and white? We're here in Oklahoma City asking the bombshell questions nobody else in the media dared to. What if he didn't do it? Did the DNA evidence really show what prosecutors accused Holtzclaw of doing? Why did the jury throw out half the charges? Why are accusers who describe the tall, dark-haired, half-Japanese cop as a, quote, short black man or blonde, now part of high-dollar civil suits against him? Forget everything you thought you knew about this case, because it might not be true at all.
Next on Michelle Malkin Investigates. Michelle Malkin Investigates. Now, here's Michelle Malkin.
Welcome to Michelle Malkin Investigates, where we dig deeper, past the headlines and sound bites, in pursuit of one narrative, the truth. This edition is the beginning of an ongoing series on CRTV about an idealistic young man, raised with small town values, a strong Christian from a multiracial family of cops dedicated to law and order, who was shockingly railroaded by his own colleagues, by the media, and by the police-hating social justice mob. I have now been to Oklahoma 3 times and personally spent dozens of hours meeting the key players, hearing from Daniel Holtzclaw's family and friends, and poring over the evidence. After carefully interviewing the lead detectives, scrutinizing the accusers' convoluted stories, and after talking to Daniel directly, I can tell you this: justice was not served. Like the biblical Daniel, Officer Daniel Holtzclaw was thrown into a lion's den, his reputation mauled, his freedom stripped. This, despite the prosecution's failure to produce a single witness or piece of direct forensic evidence tying Daniel to 17 alleged crime scenes involving 13 accusers and 36 crimes. Is he innocent? I want you to make your own fully informed conclusions, and so does Daniel.
I want the world to take notice of my case. I want the world to read in detail about my case, and I believe the judicial system failed me, and so I believe when the facts are finally presented and people can actually sit back and read and go into detail about my case, they understand what truly a misjustice has occurred.
You'll hear much more from Daniel later in our special in-depth interview. I'll also introduce you to Brian Bates, an unlikely ally and citizen watchdog on Daniel's defense team, who has worked tirelessly to debunk the tales of the accusers who helped put Daniel behind bars.
They lied on the stand, they lied to the jury, they're involved in civil lawsuits where they may collect millions. This is an injustice, and the public doesn't want to be bothered with it.
But this story isn't just about Daniel. It's a chilling warning for the rest of America, as you'll hear from Daniel's sister, Jenny.
I want everyone to be aware that this can happen to their loved ones. It can happen to their son. It can happen to their daughter. I mean, you never know what someone's going to be falsely accused of.
As Daniel's family marks the one-year anniversary of his conviction, December 10, which is also his 30th birthday, his public defender is preparing a high-stakes appeal. In late September, Daniel filed for an extension, which included bombshell information. Limited DNA tests on Daniel's uniform found an accuser's skin cells. But what you probably didn't know is it also found DNA from an unknown male. An unknown male? That certainly doesn't fit his supposed victim profile. It's a pretty significant fact that was lost on police, Daniel's original defense team, and prosecutors. Not only that, but prosecutors claimed that the accuser's DNA came from vaginal fluid. But that contradicts their own DNA expert. And for all we know, it could have transferred from a simple handshake. We'll dive into all those details and more that the rest of the media has whitewashed. But first, let's get to know more about the real Daniel Holtzclaw from the people who know him best.
Our story begins in the plains of Middle America, nestled between Texas, Kansas, and Arkansas. Oklahoma's economy depends largely on oil. The Sooner State is decidedly Republican, pro-American, and boy do they love their football. That's what made Daniel a household name and star in his small town. But before we get there, let's go back to where it all began. An unlikely love affair between an American Air Force security officer stationed in Japan and a stunning local policewoman.
It is nice weather, isn't it?
I went out and said, konnichiwa. And she says, hi, how are you? And I said, oh, she speaks English. So, yeah, we hit it off, started talking about the difference in the Japanese police and the American police. And, you know, one thing led to another. And later on, I got the nerve to call her and ask her out on a date.
And the rest was history.
35 years later, we're still here.
Eric and Kumiko had their first daughter, Julie, in Japan, followed by Jennifer in California. But the family didn't stop there.
When we moved to Guam, Eric and I, we were so happy to have a boy.
That boy was Daniel, big from the moment he popped out, and a bundle of energy from day one.
How old are the kids here?
Oh my gosh, Kumiko, what are the ages here?
About 2, and Jenny maybe 3.
Big sister Jenny was so close in age, they played sports together.
On the basketball team and, and soccer, it's they had some good times.
Who was better at soccer, you or Daniel?
Daniel.
Yeah.
He was for sure the athletic one.
Jenny says her little brother was large in stature as a kid, but also had a big heart.
I would say that, you know, personality-wise, he's always been loving, very caring, very nurturing, you know, to both his family members, to people that he cares about, he loves, you know, people that he's concerned about. That's just his personality.
On the football field, Daniel led by example.
He led the team by the way he played. He wasn't a real outspoken leader. He was kind of a quiet guy, but he let his actions and his play speak, and he was a fierce competitor.
Former Enid High School coach Tom Cobble remembers his standout star.
We got in the playoffs and played for a state championship, and he was the leader of that, so people in town were crazy over the team and over Daniel.
Daniel's proud dad, Eric, was the biggest cheerleader of them all.
You sat in these stands many times watching your son playing on the field. Tell me more about that.
I was probably the most avid fan in the stands as far as being vocal. I mean, I'd go to those games, and by the end of the game, I wouldn't have a voice left. I was yelling and rooting for the team and him all the time.
It was a happy time for you, and it must have been some of the best memories he's had here in Enid.
Yes, both ways, not only for him, but for me, the great memories of watching him play.
Daniel grew up in the spotlight in his small town of Enid, Oklahoma, population 52,000. But his sister Jenny says he always stayed humble and worked hard for everything.
We both got jobs at McDonald's starting off. I think we were about 14, 15 is the legal age that we were able to start working. So our parents never spoiled us.
It sounds like growing up in flyover country that you really embraced sort of, you know, traditional values, hometown values. And when he went off to college, he took those with him, and you too.
Yeah, nothing was ever given to us.
Thanks to his hard work and focus, Daniel earned a scholarship as a Division I linebacker at Eastern Michigan University. Sports journalist Dave Ruthenberg says right away, Daniel's intensity set him apart, with 4 interceptions to start his record-setting college career.
That first year, he registered over 100 tackles and earned freshman All-American, which, again, was quite an accomplishment to come from a Division I school that's a little on the small side.
Ruthenberg got to know him personally, too, writing about the Oklahoma boy in Michigan and eventually for Daniel's hometown paper in Enid.
I knew he wanted to play in the NFL. That was his dream. So actually, my first story when I got back here was sitting with the family on an NFL draft day and kind of doing an hour-by-hour story on draft day.
Those agonizing rounds came and went. Despite his standout play, Daniel's name was never called.
We really thought he was going to make it in the NFL, and it just didn't happen.
A disappointment like that could set some people back for life. It could be debilitating to come back and bounce back. How did he bounce back?
Well, you know, it was rough on him because he really, that's what his number one dream was. And he just had to, you know, understand that God gives you, your cards that are laid out and to make the best of them. And he did.
Daniel always had a second dream, to follow in his parents' footsteps.
And he says, you know, I got my degree in criminal justice. I see my dad doing a very honorable career, and that's something I like to do. And that's what he chose to do after that.
As the son of two police officers, it almost seemed like it was in his blood. Did he embrace the ethos of law enforcement?
I think so. And he felt integrity is important. His word meant a lot. He had a passion for it. He enjoyed making a difference.
That was what he dedicated his life to at a young age.
He did. And you know, he risked his life every day down there.
Daniel joined the Oklahoma City Police Department in 2011. In his 3 years on the force, he patrolled the meanest streets, chasing down the bad guys just like he would on the football field. And yes, he ruffled feathers. Daniel was investigated on 19 use of force incidents over that time, but cleared of every single one.
A lot of the media coverage talks about him being a quote-unquote aggressive cop. What's your response to that?
I don't think that's accurate at all. He wasn't afraid to get in the mix. He would do his job. You got to remember, he was in a very high crime area, a lot of bad people, a lot of criminals that he had to deal with.
He served a brief stint in the high-profile gang unit before being assigned to the Northeast.
Let me tell you a little bit about Northeast Oklahoma City. It's one of the toughest neighborhoods, rife with drugs, gangs, and prostitutes. This section of town lies directly in the shadow of the state capitol. And it's a place where a young man, sworn to protect and to serve, became a victim, a sacrificial lamb of the very system he had dedicated his life to.
The Northeast is a predominantly black neighborhood and one of the poorest in the city.
Race relations in Oklahoma City is tense.
Oklahoma native and accuser's advocate Grace Franklin echoes the Black Lives Matter movement's blanket criticism of law enforcement officers and paints a bleak picture of cops on the beat.
The police do not see us as individuals. They see us as statistics. They see us as assailants, suspects. That's a problem when you're policing a community.
But here's the other side of the story. Oklahoma City has been one of the most gang-infested cities in America, behind Chicago, Los Angeles, Detroit, and Camden. Violent Northeast street thugs and cartels on Daniel's beat flooded the neighborhood with drugs. Prostitution and human trafficking have also plagued the streets. But Daniel was ready for it. Coming from a multicultural family that traveled the world, Daniel was exposed to many races and cultures and did not discriminate based on skin color.
He has always hung out with all different races. His best friend was African American as well. So it was never a race issue. I've never heard him say the N-word before. I've never heard him ever speak of that race in negative light.
At 27, Daniel was carving out a promising career in law enforcement. His mission was to serve and protect. He had a girlfriend who shared his love of physical fitness. He went to church and remained close to his family. Life was good.
Mwah. Good night, baby.
But in the summer of 2014, a late-night traffic stop would change everything, and Daniel had no idea what was about to hit him.
While Daniel occupied himself with work, family, and friends, a powder keg of racial strife and anti-police fury was about to explode. Summer 2014 was the season of Ferguson, Missouri, where 18-year-old alleged thief Michael Brown was shot and killed by police officer Darren Wilson. The Black Lives Matter movement seized on the incident, and Hands Up, Don't Shoot was born. Despite being debunked by the Justice Department, the myth still won't die. Riots erupted across the country filled with chants of blank the police. In this poisoned climate of social justice and scapegoating, fingers were about to point at an unsuspecting Daniel Holtzclaw, putting political pressure on the police chief and prosecutors to calm a racially charged mob.
Oklahoma City's skyline and population have grown dramatically over the past 20 years, and with it, the crime rate. Yet law enforcement numbers have barely budged. Instead, officers work 12-hour shifts and more solo patrols. On June 18th, 2014, Daniel was just finishing up one of those solo patrols, leaving the Spring Lake Station at 2 a.m. He turned off his patrol car's computer and GPS, which was a policy violation. But for Daniel, it had become a daily bad habit for which he had never once been admonished or disciplined. Across town, a 57-year-old woman was also driving home in a red car with dark tinted windows, even though her driver's license had been suspended 3 decades prior. She says between midnight and 2 a.m., she played games with friends, took a nap, and was driving home so her fiancé could get to work. Daniel pulled Janie Liggins over here after she swerved, just west of a busy intersection. Patrol cars in Oklahoma City don't have dash cams, and officers don't have body cams. But one nearby building had 32 and 24-hour security overlooking where the supposed sexual assault happened. Here's surveillance video from one of those cameras. Unfortunately, it's too dark and far away to confirm anything other than what we already know. He pulled her over, and several cars drove by. In the 15-minute stop, Daniel says he found a bottle of hydrocodone in her purse, but let her go home without calling it in. Liggins made a U-turn, the opposite direction from where she was initially heading. So what exactly happened between Officer Holtzclaw and Janie Liggins? Liggins' story would become a national narrative, a symbol of racism and police abuse.
I was out there alone and helpless, didn't know what to do. And in my mind, all I could think that he was going to shoot me. He was going to kill me.
Her story would kick off a police investigation turned fishing expedition that dredged up more than a dozen accusers.
After I talked to Janie, I was like, something happened to Janie.
Now retired, Detective Kim Davis was with the Oklahoma City Police Department for nearly 3 decades. She says she had a gut feeling about what would become the biggest case of her career.
She said, if you picture it, he's got his penis in her mouth and his gun's right there. All she can see is his gun. And she asked him, are you gonna kill me?
Liggins says Daniel ordered her to put her hands on his car, pat searched her, ordered her to lift up her shirt, and demanded she pull down her pants, claiming he forced her to perform oral sex on him for about 10 seconds.
What was different about her?
Her demeanor. Hysterical at times, bawling at times. She had no motive at all to make this up.
According to the court record, Liggins admitted to taking a sleep-inducing pain pill and initially denied smoking marijuana, but then said she, quote, hit it once. But she also told Davis she had actually smoked 2 marijuana joints. She later denied that too. Davis interviewed Liggins at the hospital and said she was incredibly upset. We would show you the interview, but neither video nor audio exist.
We don't record victim interviews except involving police officers. We never have recorded victim interviews.
Okay, but this one involved a police officer.
It did, but I had no recording. I had no equipment to record it, and it didn't even cross my mind to record it. We're in the middle of the hospital, and it's not something we do. We don't take a recorder to the hospital and do interviews.
You don't use your phones for interviews?
No. I wouldn't even know how to record on my phone if I did.
You wouldn't?
No, I have no idea.
The veteran detective was not technologically advanced enough to record an interview on her personal phone and says they aren't allowed to either.
You don't carry work phones with you that you
We're
could use?
We're not provided with work phones.
Still, she and fellow sex crimes detective Rocky Gregory managed to tape 9 additional accusers.
If you don't know, you don't know. And tell me, I don't remember. It's okay not to remember.
But Liggins, the linchpin for the entire case, never gave a recorded statement. Liggins did, however, take something called a SANE test with a sexual assault nurse examiner.
What were the results of the SANE test with regard to Janie Liggins?
There was no DNA in her mouth.
but she said that he did not ejaculate.
She also said at one point her hands were on the hood?
On the hood, yes.
And what were the results of that?
They didn't get fingerprints.
Why do you think that is?
Because hundreds of people touched the cars, the weather, you gotta keep in mind, Holtzclaw's car was a pigsty. It was absolutely nasty. And a lot of times, like when we go, say we go into a house for a burglary, and it's just nasty, you never get results from that.
Yes, Daniel's car had trash inside, but we're talking about the outside. Police tested his vehicle all over for DNA and prints.
The fingerprint tests came back negative on the car, and the stain test came back negative for DNA in her mouth.
Correct.
You still believed her story at that point?
I did.
No forensic evidence supported Ligon's account, and her stories kept changing, casting increasing doubt on her reliability and credibility. First, she describes Daniel as 35 to 45 years old. He's 27. She claims he's 5'7 to 5'9, 225 pounds with a thick build. He's actually 6'2, very muscular. She says his skin isn't smooth, but Daniel has clear skin. And here's the kicker. In her eyes, he's blonde. Nope, dark hair. Ligon said she pulled into a parking lot after Daniel let her go before turning around. That's not what the video showed. She testified that Daniel unzipped his pants in an instant and pulled out his penis through the fly of his pants. But Daniel wears tight compression underwear without an opening at the crotch. His bulletproof vest hung below his groin, and his uniform shirt was secured to his socks to keep it taut. The scenario Ligon's described is highly unlikely, to put it mildly. Nevertheless, Davis and her partner, Rocky Gregory, were certain when they began a two-hour interrogation with Daniel that he was guilty.
We've both investigated officers in the past, but so it's a different dynamic. They kind of know a lot of the tricks of the trade that we do. They've watched plenty of our interviews when they bring other suspects down that they've arrested.
But before you started the interview, did you have a sense that he did the things that Jamie Ligon's accused him of doing?
Oh, and before we started the interview, I felt like that what Janie told me was the truth, yes.
Daniel didn't ask for a lawyer. He allowed investigators to collect his DNA and conduct any search they wanted. And speaking of searches, he told a far different tale than Ligon's.
Did your hands go on her at all?
I backhanded her on as far as the side.
Where on her body? Tell me, you backhanded
her? Her waist and the back portion. I didn't touch her butt or anything, but the back portion of the waist. And then she lifted it up like right here, and there's nothing.
Did she lift it up like this?
No.
So she never, like, exposed her breasts or anything like that?
She asked me if I was like, no, it's okay.
She asked you?
If you want to search me, I'm like, no, it's okay.
So she never like put her hands on the car and you?
No.
Okay.
Over the course of a 2-hour interview conducted roughly 12 hours after the traffic stop, Daniel is clear, calm, and answers the questions directly, never getting rattled, even when the detectives mention they have video.
On the video, are we gonna see her boobies?
Shouldn't see her boobs. I didn't see her boobs.
Okay. Are we gonna see her pull her pants down?
I didn't see her pull her pants down.
Okay. Are we gonna see your penis out?
Nope.
Are we gonna see your penis go in her mouth?
No.
Are we gonna get any DNA to that?
No.
The video the detectives mention is the dark, far-off surveillance footage we showed you. Remember, all it confirmed was that a traffic stop took place. But Detective Gregory suggested otherwise to Daniel.
And we can watch a whole lot of actions being performed while you were there. And is there any reason at all, why your penis would be out?
No.
Detective Gregory continued to press him.
These videos ain't helping.
But Daniel did not waver. And when asked about DNA, he welcomed testing.
Are we gonna get something from the same exam?
Go with the same exam.
Do you understand that you don't have to full-blown ejaculate to get something out of the same exam?
Right.
We can get skin cells, we can get pre-ejaculate, we can do all that and still get DNA.
Right.
And did your penis go in her mouth?
No, it did not.
As you know, the SANE exam results came up empty, supporting Daniel's story, not Janie Liggins. After watching the entire two-hour interrogation, I can tell you it sure seems to me that Daniel had no idea what he was accused of doing. He told detectives he wanted every test to be conducted to show he had nothing to hide.
Now I'm just feeling, oh my God, bless. I want DNA, I want everything, I want to get it done.
Based on a single two-hour interview, the detectives diagnosed Daniel as a monster.
What are some of the adjectives that you'd use to describe Daniel Holtzclaw?
Narcissist.
Psychopath.
Evil.
But Sister Jenny tells me Daniel's always direct and unflappable. And when the investigators went on a hunt for anyone in Daniel's past who would confirm their dark diagnosis, they came up empty.
There's just a wildly divergent interpretation of how he acted and how he responded to the questions.
That's Daniel. I mean, that's Daniel being straightforward with her. You know, Daniel had nothing to hide.
So what do you think of people who look at the video and say, oh, that's the behavior of a sociopath?
It's very frustrating whenever I hear people say that, because I haven't heard one actual clinical person say that's what Daniel's interrogation video proved to them.
Given that the detectives believe they were dealing with a psychopath, their failure to conduct basic searches and seizures is curious, to say the least.
Was there a reason why you didn't take his cell phone?
His cell phone?
Yes.
I didn't see.
There was no what? Reason to do that.
No. What? Take it for what?
To look at who he called or what messages were on there, and no.
Even just looking at Janie, because we only had Janie interviewed full-blown when we did this interview. There was never any allegation or any comment that he got her number, that he called her, that she called him. There was nothing to analyze his phone for.
So you didn't take his phone. What about his underwear?
Didn't take them.
Why not?
Daniel said that he had washed the underwear. He still had on the pants he had on the night previously.
And so you believed him you believed that?
Yeah.
But you already had a sense that he did what Janie Liggins said that he did.
I did.
But you believed him that he had washed his underwear.
I guess believe and hope. Most people change underwear, usually. But he had told us this is the same uniform, so we took the uniform.
What about the other uniforms that were in his home? Did you think you should have taken those?
No, because we didn't have other victims at that point.
Yet Davis told me she had another case on her mind when she interviewed Liggins.
And in the back of my head, I knew that Rocky was working another assault involving a police officer, but I didn't know the details of it.
Okay, so when you got to the hospital, you had that case in mind?
I knew he was working one involving a police officer. I didn't have any details, I just knew he was working one.
So which is it? Was there another victim in mind or not?
Well, I had a victim, Terry Morris, and her description of her assailant matched up what Jenny Liggins, her description of her assailant was, and that everything that transpired during both their assaults kind of matched each other.
Detective Rocky Gregory has been with the Oklahoma City Police Department since 2000 and spent much of his career in sex crimes. He interviewed Morris in May 2014 after a domestic incident with her boyfriend.
I'd spent like 2 weeks trying to find her. By the time I was able to locate her, she again was high, and then she refused to cooperate. She said she was moving to California, didn't want to do anything. I sensed that there was something that did happen, but she wouldn't look at a photo lineup. She actually told me a wrong location to kind of throw me off a little bit.
But why would she do that?
Well, she explained later on when she got sober. The reason why is because she knew he was going to dig into it, and she didn't want the boyfriend to know that she fell off the wagon. And the location where her assault occurred was actually at where she usually buys dope from.
Actually, the location was just a few blocks from her mother's home in a neighborhood Morris frequently visited.
So she lied to cover something up that she didn't want her boyfriend to know.
That's right.
So she changed her story.
She did change her story.
More than once.
In this interrogation, Morris seemed disoriented and unwilling to talk.
I can't have this guy running around Oklahoma City.
But if somebody else can do it, I don't want to. I just want to leave him.
Morris, a convicted felon with a history of drugs and prostitution, claimed Daniel stopped his patrol car and forced her to perform oral sex on him. But the GPS in his car disproved her initial statement. It showed a stop by apartments in the Northeast, not downtown. She could not positively ID Daniel in a photo lineup and said her attacker was dark-skinned and driving an older model patrol car, when in fact Daniel's car was a new one. Yet still, police believed her.
So the story evolved because she feared her boyfriend. The story did not evolve because she was trying to match the narrative that you had in mind.
Right. The only reason she gave a different location, again, was because she had the domestic with her boyfriend and other officers were there. He was going to know that she was on crack again.
She was trying to cover up her drug use.
That's exactly it.
That explanation makes little sense because Morris's ex-boyfriend initially called police to report she was intoxicated and destroying his vehicle. Nevertheless, the detectives believed a drug abuser over one of their own and started building their case, creating a victim profile. From thousands of Daniel's interactions with Oklahoma City residents, detectives cherry-picked black females with a history of drugs or prostitution. It's no surprise that the publicity led to a circus parade of women and even a man coming forward with outlandish claims against him.
From what I understand, there were an additional seven whose allegations didn't hold any water with you all.
There was a couple during, and then some came like during the trial and after the trial.
After it hit the media, we really had to be kind of protective as far as just absolutely even just believing anything. We had to really kind of dissect because now it was out there. Some people thought of money or just wanted attention or however. I interviewed one male.
One male who said that Daniel Holtzclaw. And what was the outcome of that?
He admitted he lied.
Yeah. So there are plenty of reasons to lie, including...
get out of trouble.
Yeah. And money, as you said, was a big factor for people. I mean, they wanted to cash in.
After they saw it on the TV, they were like, ooh, I can get in on this.
And this kind of case and these kind of allegations are sort of a magnet for people who are looking to cash in.
Right.
Yes.
Detective Davis insisted that accusers like Janie Liggins and Terry Morris had no motive to make false charges against Daniel. Yet she admitted such lies are routine and says OCPD gets a complaint monthly against an officer that usually amounts to nothing because accusers just want to retaliate against cops. And quite simply, as Detective Davis herself admitted to me,
oh, people lie.
People lie. People bend the truth to fit a narrative. People exploit a crisis for attention, money, revenge, or social justice. Perhaps most troubling is how the detectives cajoled accusers into signing on as victims, even after refusing to say that Daniel did anything wrong. As we'll show you in our next edition, others also changed their story. But a police investigation took an even greater turn for the worse when detectives got their DNA moment. Is it what prosecutors and the media have portrayed? For the whole truth, be sure to watch the next edition of Michelle Malkin Investigates.
A small-town football hero turned law enforcer. Daniel Holtzclaw had it all. The reputation, a beautiful girlfriend, a job he loved. That is, until one fateful summer night, a traffic stop that changed everything. A woman who appeared intoxicated swerved in front of him. The jovial, hard-working young police officer would be vilified in the media as a psychopath, monster, narcissist, serial rapist.
But what if they got it wrong? In this case, there are no witnesses, not a single direct piece of forensic evidence tying him to the crime scenes.
It is unheard of to have this one-man crime spree going on, all of these accusers, all of these crime scenes, all of these alleged crimes, and they can't produce a single witness, they can't produce a single piece of direct evidence.
We'll let you hear from Daniel himself, who is behind bars. He says he's innocent, and a scapegoat to ease racial tensions, railroaded by his own colleagues. And the scary part is, it could happen to anybody.
Next on Michelle Malkin Investigates. Michelle Malkin Investigates. Now, here's Michelle Malkin.
Welcome to part two of our special series, Daniel in the Den, The Truth About the Holtzclaw Case, where we dig deeper, going beyond headlines like these. Oklahoma cop gets life for sex crimes against the poor. Officials, Oklahoma City police officer accused of sex crimes fired. Officer accused of sex crimes sees support from hometown, but not from fellow officers. We'll show you the rest of the story you haven't seen.
It was devastating. It crucified me. It was hard. And that's not who I am. That's not exactly who I am at all. People want to jump to the conclusion and try to be feel good about themselves and say, well, Daniel fits that profile. I don't fit any profile of anything because I didn't do anything wrong.
In part one, we showed you the Holtzclaw family that Daniel's hometown of Enid knows. Two police officers in a multicultural love story. They raised their half-Japanese kids with traditional values of honesty, thrift, faith, and hard work. We walked you through Daniel's 2014 traffic stop and an accuser's glaring inconsistencies. We showed you that police could not find any forensic evidence of a sexual assault just hours after she claimed it happened. We raised questions about the detective's investigative methods and unsubstantiated characterization of Daniel as a monster and sociopath. And we spotlighted their willingness to overlook the shifting stories and claims from one accuser whose drug use greatly compromised her credibility. Now, in part two of our series, we'll dive into the much-hyped DNA evidence with highly regarded forensic scientist Dan Crane. Unlike the other detectives, he's a real expert, and his questions about their work on this case will not make the Oklahoma City PD bosses happy. As I found out firsthand, the OCPD overseers don't like it when you ask too many questions.
Unless he's sexually assaulting her? Is that what you're saying? There'd be no other... What if...
I'm going to interrupt here. I mean, they've answered it twice.
I know, but I'm kind of exploring.
I also understand kind of the tone this is taking, so it's time to just move on to the next question.
But first, let's head back to OKC and scrutinize even more of the accusers whose convoluted tales raise heaps of doubt about the case against Daniel. And the story gets more unbelievable. Oklahoma City has an unfortunate history. It is the site of one of the worst domestic terror attacks our nation has ever seen. A memorial now stands at the federal building where Timothy McVeigh and Terry Nichols killed 168 people. The city also mourns regularly as routine storms destroy cars, houses, and lives in a place nicknamed Tornado Alley. And finally, it's the setting of our story of injustice. The place where an entire department and city turned their backs on a police officer targeted by a racially charged mob seeking social justice over real justice. That man is Officer Daniel Holtzclaw, Daniel in the Den, now behind bars for crimes he says never even happened. In this section of Northeast Oklahoma City, Daniel Holtzclaw pulled over Janie Liggins after she swerved in front of him in June 2014. She claims he made her perform oral sex on him near a busy intersection and in view of surveillance cameras. A man she described as the wrong height, hair color, and skin type. But as lead detective Kim Davis admitted to me when asked about the common frequency of false allegations against the police,
people lie.
We know Liggins changed her story,
several times. Did Daniel?
What changed in the 2 hours that Daniel Holtzclaw gave his interrogation about his side of the story versus the all of the evolutions that happened in Janie Liggins?
Oh, nothing changed. He admitted to pulling her over. He admitted to putting her in the back. He admitted to everything that Janie said except the sexual assault.
There's no forensic evidence to back up what she said.
Correct.
And you still believe her, not him?
I do.
I assume it's because of all the other women that became a part of this case.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. When you have one victim, I believed her. But we don't always get things done when you have one victim. But when you have 13, and the MO's the same, and the verbiage is the same, it just becomes a little bit more believable.
13 accusers with the same MOs and verbiage? Actually, the accusers' stories varied widely. Some alleged vaginal rape, others claimed oral sodomy, still others said that they were forced to flash their breasts. 13 sounds so damning, until you see how exactly the pileup occurred.
Quite honestly, it wasn't just 13. 13 made it to court.
Meet Brian Bates, Oklahoma City community activist, video vigilante, and private investigator who exposes crime and corruption. He was also part of Daniel's defense team.
In total, there were 20 accusers. 7 were eliminated from the very beginning because their accusations were so outlandish, the police couldn't even forward them with charges.
I just want to stop you right there. That's stunning.
Yes.
Because I would say that pretty much there's nobody in America outside of the small circle of his advocates, friends, family, you, his team, who knows this fact.
Things that didn't get reported. There were 20 accusers. One of those accusers was a male accuser. These are people who were accusing him of stuff after he had already been put on administrative leave, during times he was nowhere around. They were crazy stories, and as crazy as some of the actual accusers who made it to court are, these people were even more outlandish. So there were 7 that were eliminated from the beginning, which left us with 13. Of the 13, only 8 was he found guilty of, which means more than half of his total accusers were already found to be lying, not to be telling the truth.
Of those 13 accusers, only 3 came forward on their own. Police created a profile of black female victims, hunted them down, and then proactively informed some of these women that they were seeking out sexual assault victims. There were no witnesses, no direct evidence against Daniel, nor that there was even a crime. Yet nearly every accuser has filed a lawsuit seeking money, even those on whose charges Daniel was found not guilty. One of these people is Carla Raines, who claimed under oath that Daniel forced her to expose her breasts. But when she first talked to the detective, Bates shows us that wasn't the case.
Have you ever come to any contact where an officer has been inappropriate?
No.
Have you ever had to expose yourself to him?
No.
Carla Raines is probably one of the most reluctant accusers slash victims, but it gives a very perfect example of the investigative process and how biased it was when they would approach these women.
Well, this is the deal. You got several victims, okay? And so we're trying to go back on this guy, and he's a pretty bad guy.
This is a woman who, throughout her interview, 7 times says not only is she not a victim, she's totally confused about what the detective's talking about, and he keeps on her and keeps on her until he finally spoon feeds her exactly what to accuse Daniel of.
These 7 women do different things.
Oh, thinking they gonna go to jail if they do a favor for him, he would.
There you go.
Okay, I know what you're talking about.
7 times she denies being a victim. Let's count.
Have you ever come to any contact where an officer has been inappropriate?
No.
Have you ever had to expose yourself to him?
No.
Okay. You wasn't asked to, if you had any drugs on you, anything like that, and you had to...
Expose myself? But I know what you're talking about.
That's the clap and shake.
No. I haven't had. How did you get my name anyway on something like this?
Because I haven't really been on the streets and stuff that much. There's only one officer that I know a few years back. He was a black cop. They used to come around here. And he exposed himself to me. I don't know if I helped you, but like I said, that's
you
only
did.
Time.
You did.
You look in Rocky Gregory's official police report, it doesn't mention a single one of those times that she said, I'm not a victim. It says from the very first paragraph, she is a victim.
Another very damning sin of omission.
Right, and I guarantee you the police chief and nobody else listened to the interview. They were provided with a hard copy report and they read that report and that report reads completely different than their interaction did. So it's not hard to understand why the rest of the department fell in line and felt Daniel was guilty, because all they have to base it on are these reports that are extremely biased in how that they're produced.
Perhaps this evidence is why jurors found Daniel not guilty on her charges. So we are looking beyond the incomplete reports and going straight to the interviews, like this one Detective Rocky Gregory conducted with Shardarion Hill.
He told me I wasn't going first, and then he told me I was, and then he was like, but if you cooperate, you know that I wouldn't go to jail.
Daniel arrested Hill in Northeast Oklahoma City when she was high on PCP and being rushed to the hospital after she crushed a glass vial of the drug in her mouth. He checked on her and followed up on Facebook, an innocuous, if unwise, gesture that was later interpreted in the worst way possible. After Daniel's face was on the news, Hill claimed he sexually assaulted her while she was handcuffed to a bed and coming down from a high in a busy hospital. Yet nobody saw.
But the very end, when the interview's over, she doesn't think she's being recorded anymore, she made a comment that even the prosecutors, believe this or not, the prosecutors had never bothered to listen to that on the tape. And when I brought it forward in the trial had to be put on hold. We all had to go into a back room so the prosecutors could listen to it because they'd never heard this before. And we couldn't play it in open court until they heard it.
So this is good evidence?
Well, you tell me.
I think so, because I mean, y'all, even if he didn't like even rape nobody or nothing, he's still been in contact with people that he arrested.
That's really important. That one statement that the prosecutors had never even bothered to listen to is the whole reason all six of her allegations were torpedoed, and the jury saw Hill for exactly who she is. She's a liar.
Then there's Sherry Ellis, someone the jury believed, even though she told police her attacker looked nothing like Daniel.
Tell me your description of him.
He's black.
He's black male.
Muscular.
How tall, could you tell? You're pretty tall. How tall are you? How tall are you?
5'11".
Is he taller than you or shorter than you?
Like right here, maybe, like that.
So you think he's shorter than you?
Yeah.
But Daniel is 6'2 and light-skinned, not short or black. Her story continues that he forced her to perform oral sex before driving to an abandoned schoolyard. Bates takes us on this route.
The GPS did not support her version of events. The GPS says they never stopped at the schoolyard. The GPS says he was only in the area for a minute or two and was simply driving by.
So we stop by the infamous former schoolyard, where Ellis claims he parked and raped her for 10 minutes.
His GPS shows that he never stopped. It shows that he went about 2.3 miles per hour. It shows that he drove through the area, he was here about 2 minutes, and that he left. He certainly didn't stop. He certainly didn't spend 10 minutes, so he certainly didn't commit the sexual assault that she claimed.
It would have been impossible.
Would have been impossible.
What he did.
But he was found guilty of that allegation.
The jury found him guilty of this, but not guilty of raping another accuser in the same park, when in her case, the GPS shows Daniel did stop here.
It simply doesn't make sense who was found guilty of what and who was found innocent, that simply the jury did what's called a jury compromise, and they decided at that point that they were just going to split the charges.
A dangerous scenario for someone accused of a pileup of 36 crimes. So Bates continues to push for Daniel's innocence. He's not getting paid, and it isn't particularly good for his reputation to so boldly defend the cop branded a, quote, serial rapist, let alone launch a website on his innocence.
And I think this is bigger than Daniel. I hope Daniel gets out one day. I hope I'm there to hold his hand and we can proclaim victory. But even if that doesn't happen, this needs to be an awakening for the rest of the public that we are going down a very dangerous road.
It's a hellish road where people convict based on emotion rather than facts. Every dedicated police officer and his or her family should be on guard. One day you're on patrol doing your job. The next, thrown under the bus in a mad rush to judgment, then thrown to the lions. The Fraternal Order of Police, for which he paid dues, wouldn't help pay for his criminal defense or fight his early termination. It was Daniel's own police chief, William City, who ultimately fired him 10 months before his trial for, quote, the greatest abuse of police authority I have witnessed in my 37 years. So much for innocent until proven guilty. Clearly, in my view, the chief did not want the next Ferguson happening in his backyard, and the black community was rallying behind the supposed victims with a group called OKC Artists for Justice, led by Grace Franklin.
We decided that when this case happened, that we were going to be voices for those women, because we didn't feel like there was enough exposure, there was not enough outcry from the community, there was not enough uproar.
And uproar it was. Wailing victims, screaming crowds, intimidating jurors, and bullying on the internet. Not just for Daniel, but for his whole family.
Digging deeper, getting answers. Next on Michelle Malkin Investigates.
We all know the term trolls, people who hide anonymously behind a user login and write terrible things to people online. I want to read you some of the messages Daniel Older's sister has gotten. I feel bad for you having to live and face the black culture, knowing that your brother is a pathetic excuse for a human. Well, he will learn dying in prison that black lives matter. Now you should ask if your brother's life matters now. I hope the other prisoners blank him, belt the blank out of him, piss on all his meals, stick his head in the toilet full of turds. Your mother is a stupid, ugly, blank whore who should kill herself out of shame, as should the rest of your family. I hope your brother suffers unimaginable pain until he is an old, old man. As in multiple big black men named Bubba, blanking him until he cries like he did in court. I'm sickened to say these are real people writing real comments about Daniel, judging him by the headlines instead of the facts. And the frightening thing is, they won.
In sleepy Oklahoma City, a storm was brewing, and it wasn't a tornado. We're talking racial tension bubbling to the surface and about to spill over.
If he wasn't found guilty, I cannot guarantee that something would not have exploded emotionally.
Grace Franklin organized hundreds of people to support the accusers during the trial.
We had a saying that, okay, if it goes bad and we actually riot, and the riot happens, okay, we're not gonna do it on our side of town, and they're not gonna let us go to the other side of town, so what are we gonna do?
So they gathered and chanted, so loud that you could hear them inside.
We want life!
The trial had started. We were so loud, the judge had to say something to the jury about us being out there.
We were hoping that the jury would have discounted what was going on in the courtroom, what was going on with the pressures of the media and the Black Lives Matter pressures and the demonstrations that were going on outside and the circus atmosphere that was going on in the courtroom. 30
years. And when he was eventually found guilty, the heckling got far worse.
Well, if I was disappointed in the judicial system, I was disgusted in the public that showed up there that night. They were literally screaming for joy as he was read guilty. And then on top of that, as Daniel's leaving, they're literally singing happy birthday to him in the hallway.
Happy birthday to you, Daniel.
I've always feared mob mentality. Mob mentality had kicked in that night. This was something that, whether or not you thought Daniel was guilty or not, this was a solemn moment.
With all the conflicting pieces of evidence, misidentifications, and false claims exposed, How did the jury find Daniel guilty on so many of the charges? Three letters, DNA. No, not the DNA of 13 accusers, just one found on the fly of Daniel's pants, which was the only area tested, mind you. The detectives and prosecutors saw this minuscule presence of skin cells, a billionth of a gram, as their smoking gun. It belonged to a 17-year-old female.
Is it bent over?
Okay.
So I didn't want to do this. And he was like, well...
You told him you didn't want to do it?
He said, well, this is what you're going to have to do. I don't want to have to take you to jail. I don't want to have to make it harder for you than it has to be.
Months after Daniel's face had been plastered on the news, police found the teen. She told Detective Davis that he stopped her, brought her home, and vaginally raped her. But the story, like so many of the others, raised bright red flags. Brian Bates points out that the 17-year-old's mom filed a missing persons report, then an assault and battery report against her daughter. Then there was this strange remark.
What did your daughter tell you?
She said, I met this really hot cop. He told me I had a couple warrants, but he said, don't worry about it. Give me his number and we're gonna go out on dates.
Who describes her rapist as the hot cop and we're gonna go out on dates and I'm just really excited about it? It doesn't happen.
And then another twist. A third female claimed she had been sexually assaulted on the same day as the 17-year-old and Janie Liggins. Yet only the DNA of the teen, the first in the timeline, was found on Daniel's uniform. So how did it get there? His defenders have a theory that detectives spurned.
I'm not gonna try to, you know, sugarcoat that or lessen that. That doesn't look very good. Then supposedly, after the 17-year-old, there are two adult females who were also sexually assaulted. Their DNA doesn't appear anywhere on the fly of the pants. And I say the fly of the pants because something that's important, they only searched the fly of the pants. They looked nowhere else. And people would say, why would they need to look anywhere else? Because one of the things you want to eliminate is you want to eliminate what's called touch DNA or transfer DNA.
Negative charge. That's what phosphate groups are all about.
Dr. Dan Crane, professor of biological sciences at Wright State University, is a leading expert on DNA. He is president of Forensic Bioinformatics, which reviews test results from criminal trials all over the world. He and his company have been involved in high-profile cases, like the Casey Anthony trial in Florida, the sniper case in Washington, D.C., and the Unabomber Ted Kaczynski.
The presence of a DNA profile doesn't tell us anything about the time frame or the circumstances under which that DNA came to be on the evidence sample.
And it's easier than you might think for one of these tiny particles to transfer.
I have two different kinds of sweetener here. I got sugar and an artificial sweetener. And I think what we can do is just show how the transfer could take place. Let me hand you the actual sugar. And I've got here a sweetener. If we just rip them open, right, I'm going to put some of my sweetener on my hand.
Whole
gram worth of sweetener. So I got a pretty sweet hand right now, right?
Mine's all now, naturally sweet.
Yeah, so the thing is that it's not going to be at all surprising if at this point we shake hands, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And we come away, and I got a lot of sugar on my hand,
same
right?
Here.
And you got a lot of sugar on your hand, mm-hmm. right? If we were now to take our hands and pick something up, like a water bottle, for instance, would you be surprised if when I put the water bottle down, we look and we find some sugar grains on that, right? I think that's entirely reasonable.
That's frightening. My DNA, the sugar, is on that water bottle, even though I didn't touch it. It transferred when we shook hands. And it gets even scarier. What if we never even touched?
If I grabbed a purse the way that Daniel did when he was rifling through his 17-year-old accusers, and I pick up an object, and if I handed it back to you,
sure.
What would be on it?
Interestingly, all that I see is sugar. I don't see any of the artificial sweetener, but I don't think it's at all remarkable that we would find some of that sugar on this article. And if I were to handle the article now, what we may find is the sugar's gone, and it's on my hand. None of the artificial sweetener is on my hand that I can see, but I've got some sugar on my hand, and if I were to rub my shirt, the sugar's gone. It's on my shirt. If we did a DNA test, we might find only your DNA and none of mine from that transfer that we've just done.
And if you had gone to the bathroom, is it possible that some of that sugar could have transferred to the fly of your pants?
Well, of course, right? There's nothing magical about the fly of somebody's pants compared to any other part of their clothing.
There's another piece of the DNA puzzle that Daniel's appellate team believes is crucial, right here in the crime lab analysis. It appears as if there are at least three contributors to the sample that ID'd the teen, including an unknown male's DNA.
Both that unknown male's DNA, as well as the 17-year-old's, was a result of transfer DNA. Does that sound reasonable?
Oh, absolutely. You know, the sky is literally the limit in terms of coming up with hypotheses about how those other people's DNA could have come to be associated with that evidence sample.
But when we asked police about it, they didn't buy it.
Is it possible that there's an innocuous and completely non-nefarious reason that the 17-year-old's DNA was on his pants?
On the inside of his pants?
No.
He couldn't have gone to the bathroom, put his hands down there?
No.
Were the pockets of the pants tested?
No.
Why not?
Why?
Is it possible that the transfer of DNA cells from the 17-year-old to Daniel Holtzclaw came from random transfer or touch transfer?
I have not worked one sexual assault case and had transfer DNA.
Is it possible?
Anything's possible. I would never say it's not possible.
Do you think it should be standard protocol to test, other areas to rule out that possibility?
Well, if we would have tested the knee of his pants, I can't say that came from a sexual assault. Does that make sense? I mean, you kind of have to use a little common sense here.
But Dr. Crane suggests common sense would mean actually testing another spot as a control.
If you think about that in the context of this case, saying that the 17-year-old's DNA was found on Officer Holtzclaw's pants, and not just his pants, but on the fly of his pants, at a first pass, this doesn't sound very good, right?
Right.
But maybe your opinion would be different if you were also told that in addition to finding that individual's DNA on the fly of his pants, it was also found on the knee or on the cuff or in the pocket or some other part of the pants that's a little bit less titillating, perhaps.
But remember, police didn't do that, nor did they fluoresce the pants or collect and test his other uniforms, including his underwear left in his laundry. And this is exactly why Daniel's defense team felt they had a strong case.
I've never seen, quote unquote, Barney Fife policing like I saw when this case was handed over to Detective Gregory. This was a man who took his list and went out and told people, I think you're a victim. Give me the details of it. This is a man who didn't find it was necessary to take a suspected serial rapist's underwear to be tested. They didn't look for semen, they didn't look for vaginal secretions, they didn't look for saliva, they didn't look for blood. They didn't care how that DNA got there. DNA's there, that's all we need. DNA is a very scary thing. People need to understand it's not like television. DNA has progressed immensely over the last decade. You can have a minute amount of DNA and can try to construct an entire story from it that's false.
Dr. Crane also expressed surprise at the investigative admissions.
I can't imagine that they would not have wanted to know why they didn't choose to test it.
Yeah.
Is a different question, and it's a curious question. I don't know that I can't give you a good answer to it. You might recall an allegation of sexual impropriety on the part of President Bill Clinton with Monica Lewinsky. What that all hung upon was a semen stain that was found on one of Monica Lewinsky's dresses even after that dress had been dry cleaned.
Obviously, it's not semen in this case, but what kind of skin cell DNA is it? In the prosecutor's closing statement to the jury, he boldly claimed, quote, DNA from the walls of her vagina were transferred in vaginal fluids onto the outside and the inside, not of his pockets, not of his cuff, not where he sits, but of the exact location she says his penis came in contact.
Is there a test for determining whether vaginal fluid was involved?
There's no widely used test in courts around the country for vaginal fluid.
So could one conclude from the DNA sample that was associated with the 17-year-old that it definitively came from vaginal fluid?
Absolutely not. Certainly not in my experience. I've never seen a test that's been presented in court where that assertion has been made.
So the jury was left with a misleading impression and convicted Daniel of raping the 17-year-old who called him a, quote, hot cop. 50 years in prison for those charges alone. Jurors found Daniel guilty of exactly half of the 36 charges piled up against him.
They didn't take all 13 and just clump them together. They studied each case individually. And some of them they did. They split the baby on them.
They split the baby. Is that justice?
Well, that's how they perceived
it. Splitting the difference when you're talking about the fate of a man's life, police officer or no, doesn't really seem to be how the justice system is supposed to work.
The defendant is guilty of the crime of rape in the first degree.
On his 29th birthday, Daniel's tears rolled down his cheeks as he watched in disbelief. His freedom snatched away in an instant, and his pain became a viral social media moment for ignorant haters, leaving his parents crushed.
We felt every emotion you could possibly feel, from anger to hatred to everything. I devoted my life to community service in the military and as a police officer. And dealing with seeing your own son being accused of these things was really rough. And they were the farthest from the truth.
And his big sister, who has been his greatest advocate, was shell-shocked.
I remember that phone call like it was just yesterday because I could just hear his voice, you know, just him being so shocked. We were all just so shocked, you know. So that was really hard. You know, I said, you know, I want you to be at my wedding, you know, I want you to. It was just hard, you know, just speaking with him. It was.
Did you hear fear in his voice? Did he seem afraid?
He seemed shocked, more shocked, shocked and then afraid. We were kind of speechless, you know, we both crying. Brother, we were just crying and we were trying to stay positive, you know, as we were so shocked.
In shock and despair, the system Daniel had dedicated his life to turned justice on its head, presuming guilt instead of innocence. But neither Daniel nor his family are resigned to fate.
It sounds like you're not giving up.
No, and I will not until Daniel walks out that door. I will not give up. And I told him that night of the verdict. I said, Daniel, you gotta promise me something, because I was so worried about him when he was in there. I said, Daniel, you gotta promise me something. And he said, okay. And I said, are you listening? And he couldn't speak. I said, Daniel, are you listening to me? And he said, yes. And I said, promise me this. I said, I will keep on fighting for you if you keep fighting for yourself. So you keep fighting for yourself, and I promise I'll get you out of there.
And Daniel understands full well the social climate and political context that set the stage for his convictions.
Do you feel that you were a victim of rising anti-police bias in America?
I 100% absolutely believe that.
I believe law enforcement nowadays are targeted.
Do you have any racial animosity towards other groups?
I absolutely don't. And I see what's going on in the world, I see all this, and the Black Lives Matter. I agree, but all lives matter. I want the world to see that, you know, this can happen to you. It doesn't have to happen to another police officer. It can happen to any male, it can happen to a female. It doesn't matter what occupation you have, this can happen to you.
The way that you were portrayed, not only in the courtroom of law, but also in the courtroom of public opinion, was as some sort of monster, some sort of racist, and some sort of predator.
If anyone knew who I truly was, they know about my character, they know who I am. I've worked so hard for my reputation, for my integrity. Everything I've done in my whole life, I've worked for. And it was simply just thrown away in a day.
For the Holtzclaw family, the financial incentives here are too powerful to ignore.
His life is being cut short because of what happened here, because of these accusers that lied for what? For blood money. For money that they're gonna get. That's all they want, is for the money.
12 of the 13 accusers have joined a lawsuit filed by civil rights attorney Benjamin Crump. That name may sound familiar because he's famous for representing high-profile and racially charged cases. He stood with the family of Michael Brown, the shooting that sparked the Ferguson race riots, and Trayvon Martin, shot by a neighborhood watch volunteer in Florida, and cried racism, even though shooters in both cases were cleared of wrongdoing. Believe it or not, he also sits on the board of the Innocence Project in Florida, which is supposed to fight against unjust convictions and wrongful incarcerations. Crump crowed that Daniel's 263-year sentence was a triumph against racism and sexism in this widely reported comment. Quote, "This is a statement for 400 years of racism, oppression, and sexual assault of Black women." While Daniel waits for his appeal to move forward, his family and supporters refuse to abandon him. His father, Eric Holtzclaw, continues to serve as a police officer in Enid, Oklahoma, working extra shifts. They spent their life savings on Daniel's defense and can no longer afford a private attorney, so they are working with a public defender. Sister Jenny has poured every ounce of energy into making her brother's story public on her website, justicefordanielholtzclaw.com. She is gathering petition signatures to ask Oklahoma Governor Mary Fallon to grant Daniel clemency. Brian Bates continues to update his website at holtzclawtrial.com. And volunteers pass out informational flyers, use social media, and contribute research to bolster his case for appeal. And Team Daniel remains strong to support those living the nightmare on the outside.
This is a typical Saturday in Oklahoma. We're fortunate to have a lot of friends and supporters here. The only one we're missing here is Daniel.
This family needs all the support they can possibly get.
Oh my God, I love it. I almost started crying.
Our heart goes out to them. We just wanted them to know that there are people here who would realize that they're good people.
All of us being here just shows the family and Daniel that they're not alone, and there's all of us.
Can you guys hear me?
Say hi, everybody, to Daniel.
Our neighbors came out, a lot of supporters that I haven't met and we haven't met, so it was really good seeing everyone come out here and support you.
It warms my heart, it warms my family's heart just to know the support out there. See all the supporters from, you know, just from the start to how much it's grown to now, and so it melts our hearts, and it definitely gives me all that inspiration and motivation to keep fighting. Thank you very much.
I'm hoping very much that wisdom and justice will prevail, and Daniel will soon be celebrating with all of us here.
We're gonna get him home. That's where he belongs, and we're gonna get him home.
We, together as a team, are going to beat this, along with Daniel.
My team and I will continue to cover Daniel's case for CRTV. And remember, veritas vos liberabit. The truth shall set you free. This week, our Bulldog Award goes to an outstanding citizen
Brian Bates, whom we featured in our Daniel in the Den series. His thorough, honest, and vigilant work on the case at HoltzclawTrial.com is a model for any citizen in the pursuit of truth. But Brian does much more. Among the many hats he wears, he's a social media pioneer. In the mid-1990s, he became a citizen watchdog when he got fed up with rampant prostitution and human trafficking in his Oklahoma City neighborhood. He picked up a video camera and started uploading videos to his YouTube channel, John TV. The channel quickly went viral. It didn't make him popular with the criminals, and sometimes law enforcement officials and local prosecutors weren't too happy either. In fact, when Bates met Daniel Holtzclaw for the first time, Daniel informed him that his police academy teachers had warned trainees to be wary of Bates. They are the unlikeliest of allies on the journey to justice. Daniel is fortunate, but so is Oklahoma City and the rest of America, whose success and well-being depends on an engaged, informed, and active citizenry.